today's service. Amen. Today, in the Christian calendar, today will be called Palm Sunday. And some of us know it in Nigeria or wherever we are from. From churches, we take palms and we take trees and whatever, or branches rather, not trees. We take branches and things like that, and we celebrate the triumphant entry of Christ to Jerusalem. Amen. And I can tell you, it's a very significant event in itself. This Christ came as a king, but we want to look at the true interpretation. Amen. I believe that Christianity is not just accepting what you hear people say. I remember yesterday we were talking, and I remember we said some of the ideas of, I'm sure I can ask anyone that came from West Africa to describe something to me. What comes to your mind? The guy that was holding a lion and had dreadlocks, right? The very strong guy. You got ready from that book from the Watchtower. That was what was impressed in our mind. But the Bible actually said that Samson was a natural man that looked like every other person. Amen. It wasn't extraordinary. So that means what we saw in the book was not the true representation of Samson. Likewise, if we read this passage that today we call it Palm Sunday or Triumphant Entry to Jerusalem, the question is this: did Jesus Christ truly enter Jerusalem triumphantly? That's what we'll be studying today. Amen. Today, so many things have been tagged or have been named, or the triumphant entry of Jesus Christ, and this one and that one, but in true essence, I want us to look at the story again and ask ourselves, did Jesus Christ actually enter to Jerusalem triumphantly? And I pray as we study, God of heaven will help us in this prayer. Before we go on, I just want to first bow our heads. I just want to first take this song to join the angels and just join the saints in heaven as we start singing this song. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus Christ will come into our life in its full meaning in the Holy Spirit. Let's open our Bible to the book of John chapter 1 verse 11. I'll read most of the Bible passages from here, amen. It's not because I like to read, but it's just because the way we set up our video recording, we have to have a mic to have it there. Amen. Let's read John chapter 1 verse 11, but when I say let's read, I want you to have to open to read. I'll take some time to let you get there, that we should be all ready together. Amen. So he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. John. John chapter 1 verse 11. Yes. He said he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Amen. So, if we actually say that what we read in our text today in our Bible reading, Matthew chapter 21, verse 1 to 7, and it's also that same account in the book of Luke 19, 28 to 48. There's a little bit of variation there, but there's the same thing in there. They're all saying the same thing. It's like if I tell you that I want to tell a story, and my wife's job is going to tell you. And I miss the red car that went by on the street, and I talk about the red car, and I not talk about the woman that had a red wig on her head. And I talk about the woman who had a red wig on her head. Amen. So when people say, well, the Bible is not consistent, I'll tell them, you tell me a story, and I'll go ask your son. Same story, and they're both telling the truth. But you might find some things, I'm not being that story in the style story. Amen. But what I just want to bring out is this, if we actually read from Matthew chapter 21, 1 to 17, and Luke 19, 28 to 48, and people call it the triumphant entry to the Israel, then what do we say about John chapter 1, verse 11? In John chapter 1, verse 11 says, Jesus came to his own, and did not receiving. Then it is actually natural fact that Matthew chapter 21, verse 17 actually receiving, but that means John 1:11 is wrong. But thing is this, many of times Christians are just love to just take what? We always want to have a reason to celebrate. And we actually just call it, let's call it something. We need to do one celebration. And let's call it Palm Sunday. To give this guy transparently entered into a great father. And let's give money on that day. And of course, everybody quickly starts saying, oh, so let's just enter into the son transparently. You just entered into the great father. But did he enter transparently? That's our topic today. The topic of today is called Transparent Entry Indeed. Triumphant entry indeed. Amen. I'll tell you, today we preach God's gospel everywhere. But the people who see this Christ are the way we preach the gospel? No. And I pray that we'll pray today, God of heaven, we are talking to Jesus' name. So I'm going to now, I'll point to you several reasons or seven things that show that this Christ, judgment is king to his own. His own is not receiving. The way they should. Amen. And that is the first place we're going to start from. So, and I want you to answer that question yourself. Did Jesus actually enter into Jerusalem triumphantly at many prophets? The good news of seven things that showed otherwise. The first thing is the outward praise. Amen. Let's open our Bible to Matthew chapter 21, 8 to 9. Matthew 21, from verse 8 to 9. Amen. Matthew 21, 8 to 9. I'll let everybody get there before I leave. He said, a very large crowd spread a cloak on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowd that went ahead of him and those that followed him shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The first thing you ask yourself is it possible to declare a man a king today? And in 5 days, you kill him. Is it possible that you declare a man a king and God and a son of God today and in 5 days you take killing? This fact is declaring that Jesus has entered into Jerusalem triumphantly to Jerusalem. Because we also intend Jerusalem that you are being killed. So if you, and if I'll tell you, in the next 5 days, Christians that this fact you'll be killed over 2,000 years ago. You've already dead, so you can't do it again. But in 5 days, on Friday, we'll be no one o'clock. So, is it possible that you think that people that declared him as a king today actually are not saying also on Friday at church? We leave Barnabas to us, we watch him criminal, but kill this man called Jesus. Amen. Let's go on. He said, no, unless the declaration was a fraud. Amen. I said here, he said the praise of Jesus while he was entering the city was an upward acceptance of the present Jesus. Amen. And first of all, you need to understand where Jesus Christ was coming from. If you read that passage, he said, this is the place called Bethlehem. B-E-T-T-H-A-G-E. Amen. He got a place called Bethlehem. And he stayed there and he told them, go get me a donkey. And he said, I will ride it into the city. And Bethlehem and Bethany were very close places. Bethany was the place where he moved up Lazarus. So, not long ago, this guy just moved up Lazarus from the grave. And of course, let me tell you, even if, this guy was made of us saying that there are some ministers of God that are good work and are fraud. But because people see miracles, they still go there. Because of what this guy has done, and I'll still go on and show you that there were not the people of Jerusalem that were shouting this praise for God. There were the people from Bethany and Bethlehem that actually were singing about this praise. But when they got to the city asked, who is this? So the city is asking, who is this? Yeah, who are they singing? I want to just ask them and answer the question. That means it's not the same crowd in the city. There were people that were from the other places. Amen. So this, first of all, you need to see that the praises that were singing of Jesus, it was an outward acceptance of the present Jesus. And they actually called him a what? When they asked them, that who is this? Who is this? When did the city ask them? He said, it's a prophet from Galilee. Amen. tables on the outward front of the praise of Jesus. The praise of Jesus while entering the city was an outward acceptance of the presence of Jesus, but the crowd and the city knows nothing about Jesus as the Savior. So if they do, the Lord has killed him in the next 5 days. If they did know that he is God, they won't kill him. Amen. Yet Jesus came to Jerusalem to declare God's purpose. But for the scripture to be fulfilled, the praises have to be strong. If you read the book of Luke, let us open our Bible to the book of Luke, chapter 19, verse 40. Amen. Luke 19:40. I know that this teaching is contrary to everything you've always learned as a child. But I want to open your heart to God. Amen. Because many of us always thought this has wrote triumphantly into this power. Amen. If the king wants to ride into a city, he rides on a horse. He doesn't ride on a donkey. When this guy was born, he was supposed to be born in a palace. But the Bible said there was no place for him. That he was born in a manger. Amen. Not only he born in a manger, he was not even in. Amen. Let's read the book of Luke, chapter 19, verse 14. I read it, I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. Do people like it or not, Jesus Christ has to be enchanted into the city. So, if you like it or not, somebody must go to Babalao, somebody must do something. Then, and the reason is you need to the prayer that you are not that person, that you are giving yourself to the devil to do anything bad. Jesus Christ said, out of this 12, one person must betray me. And they were all asking, is it me? Even Jesus was asking, is it me? And Jesus said, what would this is happening to this boy with me? Yeah. Anyway, I want you to explain to you that said, you know, when you appoint your degree, he said, Jesus, why are you giving yourself to the devil? And the Bible said, immediately, he speak of the devil came upon him, and he went to do that which he had been supposed to do from the beginning. Amen. It is the scripture that is written that Jesus Christ has to be enchanted. It is the Christian that the Christians have to be preached. We like it or not, the gospel must be preached. That was like Peter said, Paul said, whatever reason anyone preaches the gospel for, either from selfish gain or from self-glory, no matter, don't be bothered. As long as Christ be glorified, let Christ be preached. Don't worry about that person. You don't worry about the vessel, like preaching the gospel, like what I said today. You don't worry about how they spend the money. You don't do your own. Amen. You like it or not, the gospel has to be preached. Somebody has to do it. And some of us people don't really have to be doing it sincerely. Amen. But I pray that we will be doing it sincerely in Jesus' name. Because the most horrible thing is that at the end, after I've done all this, Friday, yesterday, we just speak to about, I just came to about 1 o'clock. Amen. And I wake already 5:30 this morning. Amen. And that tell me at the end, and tomorrow I'm going to work. At the end, when this Christ is going to come, I'm not going to hell. If I know that I'm going to hell, I'll be the best sinner the world will ever know. Amen. I may not become gay, but I'll do very pastor. Amen. And I pray, but I know that I have a hope in heaven, and that's why we're doing this. So many people that are like Jerusalem, they are outwardly think that they are of God, that they accept God, and they say, oh, the many people think of them as people who have accepted Christ. If you look from the outside, but in the actual fact, these people have nothing to do with Christ. They do all religious expectations, but indeed, they crucify Christ inwardly. Many are speaking, I want to begin to respect it on yourself. People are saying, oh, Hosanna in the eyes, they do religion, and I can tell many people, Christians are doing this. Appearance. The Bible said, until a third of the church falls away first, Christ will not come. You like it or not, a third must fall. A third of the church fell. A third of the church will fall. The same way, the love of many will not fall. The love was not fall from the beginning. The love was fall. But the time will come when the love will not fall. But I pray you never be that number in Jesus' name. And let me tell you, there's no name that is written there. There's a number. It says, unto that number of those as we complete them, then the hand will come. Let's open our Bible to the book of Isaiah, chapter 29, verse 13. And somebody else can open to Matthew 15:8. If you actually have the mic, please read. Please read Matthew 15:8. I'll read Isaiah 29, verse 13. He said, the Lord says, if people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me, their worship of me is based on merely human rules. They have been taught. They know to go to church on Sunday, they know to pay offering, they know to do tithes and do all that, but their heart is far from Christ. These people knew that they had to enchant Jesus Christ into the city, but they have nothing to do with Christ. Today they are saying Hosanna in the highest, but on Friday they'll be saying kill him, crucify him. Amen. Let's read Matthew chapter 15, verse 8. You can read now.
Okay.
15, 8.
These people honor me with their lips.
Yes?
But their hearts are far from me.
These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Are you one of those people? Isaiah 29, 13. I was sending it out to everybody. If you don't get it today, it will be on the website by 5 p.m. Amen. If you don't get it on the website, you'll find it there by 5 p.m. I said 5 p.m. so because when I go home first, I'm going to sleep first. Yes! Amen. What? Amen. I think I'll be able to do this now. So the first question is this. Are you doing the outward acceptance and praise to God when you're just chanting it? Oh, God, I love you. God, I like you. But yet in your heart that is fine. Amen. The second thing is this. The city does not know who Jesus was or who Jesus is at all. If you read Matthew chapter 21, verse 10, the Bible said, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was scared and asked, who is this? Amen. Amen. I think all we are going to do is now. He's making things that came in the river and water. The Bible said in the book of Matthew chapter 21, verse 10, when Jesus entered the city, they were all scared up and they asked, who is this? And yet we claim, this is the next one. They have no idea who Jesus is. The city we claim that Jesus entered into and it was seen over did not know who Jesus was. This passage also reveals that the crowd that was thinking of Jesus' praise was not of that city, but somewhere else. Amen. These are already identified in the beginning with a best name and a best name. Likewise today, there are many Christians who claim they know Christ, but yet they have nothing, they have no personal relationship about God. I'll tell you, when I first gave my life to Christ, the Bible said I know I'm jumping around. The Bible said the Berean Christians were better Christians. Why? Whenever they were taught by Paul, they went back home and studied to see if it was true. Many people will take whatever any pastor says for the gospel truth. Oh, he says it, then I'm not doing it. If you imagine, how can somebody say they want I want to give you the bread of life to eat, and they take you off and say, start eating grass. I tell you, show me, okay, you too, stop the grass. How do you say, eat the grass? You know, I'm wearing grass today, so I'm supposed to be more sophisticated, so I think stop the grass, but I think you don't know. Amen. But really, imagine how people could be so gullible, where they're going to be point where someone tells you to eat grass. I'll tell you, first of all, show me in the Bible where it says, as you eat grass. I'm not an animal. You tell me that something is vegetable. I'll say, okay, maybe you send the baby on Genesis chapter 1. Not go out and kneel down on the ground and be eating it like a goat. Amen. But today the people will do that. And the things they're doing for Christ. Today somebody speaks on you and they say, oh, it's the anointing. If you speak on me, you can speak my own mouth. Amen. I'm not supposed to say that, but I know I won't do that. But this is this. We need to actually begin to learn by ourselves who is Christ. Don't come to from the face value, whatever I'm telling you. And people see that I'm talking. Don't come to the Bible in the book of Prayer, they said, take all things which are of God. Amen. I can say that Peter gave Jesus revelation in the Bible. He said, Jesus, you are the Son of God. And Jesus said, nobody has revealed this to you except my Father in heaven. In the next moment, Jesus told him, get behind me, Satan. So please don't think it's because I held this mic today and I told you that Jesus can come to find you your life, that I cannot give myself to the devil. I can see human beings are human beings. That's why they call them man of God. They're not God. They are men. So please, don't want to be a word for the, it's gospel too. Let us give ourselves to God instead of just be men. Amen. And I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. So please, don't consume God's power. Well, because when people don't even know who God is, they can't tell you who God, what God's character. When things happen and people and some false prophets say some things, people can detect and tell themselves that this can be God. Amen. So we need to have a personal relationship with God. So God will help us in this name. Let's open our Bible to the book of Psalm 103, verse 7. Psalm 103, verse 7. He made his ways known to Moses, his deeds to the children of Israel. Amen. He made his ways known to Moses, but his deeds to the children of Israel. Many Christians only know the deeds of God, but they have no idea what God's acts, what God's ways are. Let me tell you, you can know God's deeds and yet go to hell, but you can never know God's way and go to hell. Psalm 109. How can a young man keep his way from sin? He said, by appealing to the God's word. That's the only thing that can teach you. The Bible also says in the book of Matthew chapter 7, verse 22 to 23. Matthew 7, 22 to 23. So please, you need to remember, you can know God's deed. God can give you a miraculous child. God can give you a job. God can open a seat for you. God can touch the heart of your boss and get the seat to hell. Yes, you explain God's deed. But if you don't know God's way, you are going to hell. The Bible says in the book of Daniel chapter 10, Daniel 10, 31. He said, they that don't know their God will be strong and they will do extra. And they will certainly resist him as the enemy. Amen. Let's read Matthew chapter 7, 22 to 23. Matthew 7. Yes.
Many will say to me on that day.
Many will say to me on that day. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Then I will tell them plainly.
I never knew you.
You know, you don't even say that
I knew you once, you fell back. I never knew you. Get behind me, you individual. Amen. You need to learn, you need to understand that the difference between the Jesus that the media portrays and the Jesus himself. There's a difference between the Jesus many people speak about on the pulpit. I can tell you there's a difference between the real Jesus people speak about on the pulpit. Oh, just come to Christ and everything will be yours. You just have money, you have wealth. It's true that all that is in Christ. But it says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and every other thing shall be added unto you. First of all, seek first. Amen. I think God will help us in Jesus' name. We need to understand the difference between all the things that we've been talked about as Christians and what we know as Christ. You know, we need to actually learn for ourselves who Christ is. Paul, after all his achievements, he said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Amen. You know, we need to actually need to know God for our own self. Don't let other people tell you about God. Don't let people tell you about the Jesus who is going to save you. But you need to learn for yourself the Jesus that saves you. Amen. Amen. The city that we claim against that came into triumphantly does not know anything about Jesus. Amen. And so right now, if I tell you some things, some people will say, would that be possible? That some things that we ask you to do. There's nothing you should be able to keep away from God. Abraham, after he has waited 25 years, God told him, Abraham, give me your son, your only son. You won't be yours the month. I want to sacrifice him to a mountain I will show you. The next morning, he took that child and start going. If God, you actually have two. You have two. He's like to leave you. No. Men, he's like easy for men to do. You have two. God said, take your first son. The one you love the most, because I'm not the one you love the most, and that's what they say in the public, but the one you love the most, that looks like you the most, take him to Africa and leave him to Ghana. Forget him there. That's where you see anointing. What? With who? No, I want to raise my child myself. In Nigeria, when there's no water in, how about you just go around? Honestly, most of us will confess. It's not even so, it wasn't true. And the other thing, all I'm saying is, take him to Nigeria and leave him there. You leave him there for the next 18 years. You see how a woman will react. Don't worry, you're not going there. Amen. But you better say you might be going to a boarding school. Amen. Amen. I think that we all continue. What I'm trying to say is this. We need to know for ourselves who Christ is. Amen. I pray it will help us to do this. You need to know yourself personally. Ask yourself today if you know Jesus, who rides on a donkey, who is well, to your heart today. Amen. That's the question we need to ask ourselves. Amen. And the third quality that shows that Israel, Jerusalem, during that God rides traveling with Jerusalem was, he was only called a prophet. Amen. When you simply ask that, who is this? But who is this that is writing on? Let's read Matthew chapter 21, verse 11. The prophet said, is this the prophet from Galilee? Is this just a prophet? No. Yes, it's a prophet, but it's more than a prophet. He is God himself. He is the king of Israel. And yes, they called him such a prophet. Many of us see Jesus Christ as a means to an end. We see Christianity as a means to an end. I know some people go to certain churches because of the prime time that we have. You know, the bigger the church, the bigger your prime time. Imagine if you write a book in a church that has 10,000 people. You're so sure the pastor is going to ask everybody to buy one. And if everybody buy one each, and you make $4 on each book, that makes you 40 grand already. Then why would you leave such a church and go to a place where there's only 20 people? And those 20 people, they don't even have enough money to even buy a book. They're the one that you're giving them. Many people are using Christ as a means for an end. They're only saying about the prophet because he was the man who was of Lazarus. They didn't see him as the king who's going to reign over them. They didn't see him as the one that the man as the God who's coming down to save them. They saw him as a prophet that was able to lead one of the dead men in our city. Amen. So ask yourself today, are you seeing Christ as a means to an end? Or are you seeing him as the savior of your soul? I think that we all present in his name. Matthew chapter 21, verse 12 to 13, also says that there were thieves and robbers in the temple. The Bible says Jesus entered the temple court and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overcame the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called the house of prayer, for you are making it a den of robbers. The body of Christ today is what place in the world that harbors the worst people on earth. Today, if you want to find the worst people, you find them in the church. And I've actually encountered the story. I'm not just saying because somebody told me. If somebody who has cheated you, kicks you from the church. And honestly, I think in the 80s, in the 70s, in the 80s, if you call yourself a sister, a brother, a born again, everybody knew that this person cannot do anything bad. If you want this reference in Nigeria, I heard that in the 70s and the 80s, you call yourself a born again. As long as that bank knows that you are walking, you are going to church and you are born again, they don't need references. They know that you cannot embezzle their money. But today, Christians are the biggest embezzlers. We are the worst people. You find the worst people. I won't say we are because Christians are not supposed to be bad. You find the worst people among all. The homosexuals, and they say, oh, I'm just trying to be flamboyant. I don't know forever said why a man wants to be like a woman. Amen. Or wants to be a woman. Amen. You have been made a man, you made a man. You have made a woman, you made a woman. Amen. Today, the most disrespectful people are found in the church. Amen. You find, the Bible says, I have friends, luckily I have, right now, at least now, as I say boldly, as a Christian, I now have friends that are not Christian. So I know how to relate. And I said, these people are people who love them. You can see, this is like the folk life, they're the folk life. And it's the people who love among themselves. For Christians, don't do that. Amen. And or you find people in Christianity that don't do that. Let me tell you, people don't do that. Yeah, I know I do that. And some of us, we do that. You know, I know we do that. But this message is for those who are thieves and robbers, honor the camouflage as Christians. Amen. The Bible said, when I was speaking to Timothy, I believe, or Titus, he said, just people who have put themselves away into the body of Christ, they are like weeds trying to snatch from the body of Christ. Amen. So today we see that right here we find homosexuals, pedophiles, thieves among and the right among the impure in the name of religion. They say, and even other religions, all other religions that we claim, that we say, God can't take it to heaven like Islam. They are more disciplined than Christians. Why? We use our own freedom as a liberty for anything. We use it as an excuse to do all kinds of immorality. I think God will help us in this name. So then we hear all manner of excuses why people are, why this kind of people are in church. If people say, oh, if we kill them out, if we kick them out, how can we change them? We don't need to bring them in like that. Let us go out and meet them in their hotels, in their places, and change them and bring them to church. Not they become part of all. They're like cancer in our midst. I think we are possibly the same. So I think we're going to ask ourselves, if Jesus comes today, will you be among the thieves and robbers? Which you will take out from the church? Ask yourself today, will I be considered a thief and a robber in God's eyes? And it's true that some of us might not do as much as the homosexuals and the pedophiles and the murderers, but some of us don't pay our tithes diligently. Like what I said, 10%. And yet you see, I have to do this. So I pay 10% of my net or my draw. Just pay 10% first. Amen. And yet some people don't even pay the 10%. And I hate to say this because I've heard other men of God say it, and I want to say, and I kind of tell myself, it's really the same in the draft. By God's grace, myself and my wife, we have two sources of income. Apart from our regular income. On our regular income, and I can tell you, if I have $50 million today, I need it. Even $100, I need it. So don't think I have money anywhere. But what I'm going to say is from our regular income, we pay our 10%. From the other one, we told God from the first day, if you do this for us, we give you 20%. So don't think that when you see our tight basket is what we earn there, we don't earn that pay. It's 20% yet. So don't think that it is what we earn. Amen. But we make a comment with God and say, God, we want to go beyond the 10%. You see, my thing is very nice. But then tell me, even if you still leave it, it's not fair enough. So why don't you give it to God still? Amen. I pray we all have to give you this prayer. So if Jesus has come today, will he find you as a thief, as a robber, or will he find you as one emerging and who lives according to his will? Yes. Fine. Amen. I pray that we all have to give you this prayer. The fourth one is, the scribes and the Pharisees wanted to stop people from clamoring the praise of Christ. Amen. Read the book of Luke chapter 19, verse 39, and Matthew 21, 15 to 16. The Bible said, the teachers came to Jesus Christ and said, stop these people from saying these things. Amen. So, one would assume that it is the unbelievers that should be the number one enemy of the church. But we see today that in Jesus' day, faith is also in our today's world. Amen. The greatest antagonists of Christians, or the people of God, are Christians. Jesus said, no other religion rises up against itself except Christianity. And it's true. Have you ever seen Muslims fight themselves and they speak against themselves? No. Have you seen Indian people do it? Muslims, that's why they all pray differently. If you see one that prays like this, it's different from the one that prays like this, you know, the one that prays for God. But they all pray differently, and they are different steps, and yet they all worship together in one mosque. But it's almost impossible that you will find all believers in Canada come together to sit down in a place and say, you are all Christians. That is when they say, you are Catholic. No, you are even Seventh-day Adventist, you are Jehovah's Witness. And even among Pentecostal people, we say, I am like Chapel. You concentrate on praise, you concentrate on prayer. You know, we say, no, I concentrate on word. Amen. I pray God will help us in this prayer. So even among us, that is where you find the greatest secret. And many of us are actually giving ourselves as a tool to be used by the devil. Amen. So one of the greatest errors to be done is to try to stop the progress of God's word. For Jesus himself said that such persons who condemn themselves first before he died. If you read the book of Matthew chapter 9, verse 42, the Bible says, if anyone causes one of these little ones to backslide or to fall, to stumble, it is better for him to hang upon his own neck a millstone, which is in Nigeria, it's called Allah. It's very heavy. It's better for you to hang it on your neck and you bump yourself in the sea. It's better for you to condemn yourself first before you even go back to you. You know, it's a very serious thing for you to start to resist God. And we see that even in the Israelites on that day, these people were trying to stop God's work. And likewise today, many people are trying to. And like every point I give, I want you to reflect on it and ask yourself if you are one of those people that are trying to live God's way. Amen. And that is why I try as much as possible to stay away from pointing to any man of God. Because if you point to somebody else, somebody will point to you. I remember when we were talking one day and somebody said, oh, it's not good for believer to be extravagant. And I believe that people should not be extravagant. And I told that person, yes, that I know you an example. But yes, I remember that I heard that one man of God had a baby toilet bowl. To me, I think it's extravagant. And that person said, but if you have a Morano, in my mind I'm like, okay. And then I thought, what did I do that? Because I was driving something smaller. I was pointing to somebody else that taking a poop in a golden bowl. Somebody is also pointing at nothing, but you're driving also a car. And I'm sure that I'm going to Volkswagen. Somebody will say, what can you be walking? What can you take this plane? Some people think you buy to go. Amen. I think that we all have to do this thing. So the 51 is this. Jesus went over Jerusalem. If Jesus Christ was actually king, if he came into Jerusalem victoriously, he will not be beaten. So let me look at the 19, verse 41 to 42. Luke 19, 41 to 42 says, as he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city. He wept over it and said, If you, had only known on this day what will bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. Amen. The city, peace came to it and it is not even recognized. Amen. That was what I said. What do you think you are boasting on? You think you have a very beautiful temple. No stone will be laid on the other one. They will remove every stone from the other one. Because the actual temple was coated with gold. So, of course, if I go to that city and I want to look at it, what will I have to do? Put every stone apart. Because every stone was coated with gold itself. So it brings that. Amen. And that's why one of the gates, beautiful gates. Because they said when the light shines on it, the pearls and everything on it makes it glow. Amen. Just by God, just by God, I'm going to teach you. This part is mostly ignored during today's event. This part that I read is mostly ignored in today's event. People were emphasized on the chanting of Jesus as the king when he entered Jerusalem, but failed to indicate Jesus' response over Jerusalem. Just by God, over the city, it's not just about it. Do not focus on people's words, but Jesus. What will Jesus say about you today? Will he cry over you because of the pending doom you are walking into? Or will he rejoice over you because you have accepted him as King and Savior? Please do not be blind to the message that brings you peace like Jerusalem, but rather welcome him into your heart today. Amen. Jerusalem is going to him on that day, and that was why 70 years later, about 1870, he was torn down. So please let us in the sweet Christ with all our hearts. Amen. I pray we help us to do it. And my last one, the seventh one is this. Jesus led the city to sleep somewhere else. If I'm a king, but where does the sitting upper stay? Canada. Why? This is his country. This is where he got his king over. But this guy cannot stay in Jerusalem. Why? They didn't really receive him. He went to sleep where? Trust me. Let's open our Bible to Matthew chapter 21, verse 17. It says, and he left them and went to the city of Bethany, where his home was. Everything resides in the core of the city. But it was not so for Jerusalem. The city did not have a place for him to sleep at night, as Bethlehem did not have a room for him. His birth. In the book of Luke, chapter 7, the Bible said there was no place for him in the inn. Amen. He was born in the manger. When he walked into Jerusalem, he was going to be king over. When in the second coming, he's coming as a king. And he's going to take his seat in Jerusalem. At that time, they have no choice. Amen. I don't believe that I'm a very secure person. I'm already imagining how you're going to come down on that day. Because the Bible said he's going to ride in heaven, he's going to be riding on a white horse with his horse in him. And I know I'm going to be on that horse. I'm telling you, if you've ever been in a gang or if you've ever been a naughty person, if you're doing something bad, maybe some of us will know. If you're driving a very good car, it's a difference when you're driving a very good car or you're driving a family. If you're driving a very good car, the way you sit in it is different. You just keep your hand and it's like, no. Maybe my wife goes to you, you're like, yeah, oh no. On that day, I might not be able to do that now. But I know on that day, I know I will be coming down with you. See, the Lord said on that day, his eyes are like fire. If you have seen a baller before, B-A-W-L-E-R, you feel like they own everything. The way they people talk, they're like, they're just sitting like, I'm like, because of the small thing you have, you are just in there. But on that day, we're all going to be lying down in glory. Amen. And we'll all be sitting down. And I'm asking God, I do not have Canada as my own. But on that day, I'm not going to take Jerusalem. The 12 apostles already have Jerusalem. Amen. I want Canada. If they're not going to give me the whole of Canada, I want him to put me as a cargo. So I can tell them, when I came before, I was teaching the new people in life that we not be at it. So it's crazy. The Bible says, when you call the nations with the word, with the scepter of iron. You're not going to have nations at that time. And I know I'm a very good, and I don't want to say I'm a very, yesterday the teacher said I'm a very soft person. Because people were saying, they think I'm going to fall to you and my children when they come. So, you have no idea. Honestly, I'm very firm. I'll speak to everybody, amen. My takeaway of being the same. So if Jesus is walking away from you to sleep somewhere else, I want you to ask yourself, are you making ready your life for Jesus to be a king? These are the questions we need to ask ourselves daily. Don't make Jesus a stranger in your life. You only pass it by to do miracles, to do one or more miracles, and go to sleep somewhere else. You don't let somebody just come to you. Don't let this guy be the great guy that comes through only one pastor. When the pastor prays for you, you get a blessing. But this guy is going to stand with you. Let him be standing with you. Amen. And I pray we all continue to return. So now the last question is this. Where do we need to be? Amen. Bethlehem and Bethany. The cities we should be. I don't want you to be like Jerusalem on that day. I want you to be like Bethlehem and Bethany. Amen. Amen. And the first thing you need to do, there are only two things to do. The first thing is this, to make yourself ready. The donkey and the colt, the colt, came from Bethlehem. It's like they go to the city ahead, you find a donkey and a colt pie. If they ask you, tell them the master is in need of it. And indeed, they got there, they found it, they took it, and somebody asked them, why are you going to present the master is in need of it, and he let it go? Let somebody walk into my house and tell me, I need your car. Not even say, who said who? I need your car. I say, why? The master is in need of you. I say, the master does not live here now. 911 will come and carry you. But on that day, this man let it go. Please, I'm asking you today, because I want to be like Bethlehem, that this is all death to God. Both the donkey and his car. At least if they take the course, you take my donkey, you have another one. They took both, and yet you are going to give that to them. So please, let me know what I wrote here. Jesus was confident of Bethlehem and Bethlehem, that the people of the town would give to him what he needs. He needed a donkey and a car, and they surrendered it willingly to him. Though we may not say Jesus was riding to this town, but this town was more receptive to Jesus than the town of Amen. In heaven, there are many surprises. One of them will be, who do you think to be there will not be there? Who do you never expect to be there? I'll give a very say, a pope and a taxi driver died someday and they went to heaven. When they go to the gate, St. Peter asked them, that's not how it's going to happen in heaven. Please don't even think that. The main apostle listened to them. They said, if somebody gave me a book after you die and back to you, what's your name? Amen. No, that's not good. The Bible said, when the rich man died, he went straight to hell. When the Lazarus died, he went to him and took him to heaven. So forget about you standing somewhere and they're asking you where you're going. As soon as you're going somewhere. Amen. So I'll go on with my story. So when the man died, so they said, when the man died first, they gave him 10 crowns. So when the Pope saw him, he saw 10 crowns on the reception and said, oh, ha, ha, ha. Me? That means I'm going to get 1,000. When he got there, he gave me 1 crown. Ah, you know what? Why would he give me 1 crown? He said, that guy, who was a man by myself, 10 crowns. He said, when you preach, men fear. When you know, men pray. Amen. And I'll tell you, there will be many surprises in heaven. Many people, the Bible says in the book of 1 chapter 4, verse 1, it says, many of you cannot be teachers, for teachers will be more strictly from. What you will do, and God cut you. I can't do it, and God cut you. I used to watch movies on the internet, but somebody said, pastor, from that day, no more. And I can tell you, the last time I came to your house, I told my wife, I have to stop myself, not to keep him to tell you, but to put that through. Because at least I was thinking in my mind that if a good day, if I sit down, to put it on. I was just, I can't change the house. I told her, but my mom said, no, you can't do this. Yeah, you can't watch it at home, then go and watch it somewhere else. You know, I tell myself, I've not used my own hand, the place is flipped. And that way, when they were watching the other one, I was trying to look away, but I can't change it. And luckily, I was asleep when the other one came up, and I woke up and I studied it. But what I'm trying to say is this, they just desire to always want to do that. But please, let us surrender our stuff to God. I think that will help us to do it. And lastly, as I close, I know we're going to be our time. Be the safe place for Jesus. Jesus Christ did not see Jerusalem as a safe place to sleep. But he saw Bethany as a place to stop before it. Before he went to Jerusalem, he stopped first. The Bible says in the book of James and Matthew 21, he said, he stopped there and he told them to go to Bethany to get something from him. He stopped there first. So please, let Jesus Christ see you as that safe place to rest before it takes its next step. Amen. Jesus Christ stopped to prepare at Bethany, and he went back to rest at Bethany. Be the safe place for Jesus to be in the world today. Let Jesus be able to count on you that in order to reject him, you will receive him and give all you have to him. Let Jesus be your priority and let him start and finish the work in you. You don't have to be a priority in the eyes of the world, but be a safe place. You don't have to be a big personality in the eyes of the world, but please be a safe place for Jesus to be able to feel confident to come and see. Amen. And I pray you are to be a safe place.